Holy Land, a 2016 biblical journey.
I'd like to welcome you to the land of Israel. We have a very special guest today. This is Elder Don Esposito. He is our guide in the land of Israel. And by the way, we're in the land of Israel. You can see the old city behind us. But Don has a different belief, a theory with the temple and where it was originally located. It's very fascinating. And we wanted to share that with you. So Don, help us understand where you believe the temple was originally located and possibly will be rebuilt.
Yes.
And why?
Yes. Just to start, it's something about 15 years ago, I read a book by Ernest Martin, The Temple's okay. Jerusalem Forgot. And it had a lot of information on this subject, and that's what really started the wheels turning. And then you come here and you're kind of looking, and in a short time like this, it's hard to get in everything, but what I want to do is maybe try to make the most, the observations that the people can understand the easiest,
let's say.
First of all, we're looking in front of us, which most people believe is the Temple Mount.
Yep.
And why do they believe it's the Temple Mount? Because coming from the 13th century, when the Jews started coming back to Israel, there was up there where they call the Dome of the Rock, it was a church of the Crusaders at that time called the Temple of Domini. Okay. And because of that temple that was there, they said, well, if this is the Temple of Domini, this must have been the place where Solomon's temple was. And then, of course, later the Muslims took it back under Saladin and they made it back into the mosque again.
Where's the historical records for the existence of the church in place of the Dome of the Rock today?
Yes.
Where do we find that?
You can look from the Bordeaux Pilgrim and Josephus, and there's different things that show that there was a church there, an octagonal church that was called the Church of the Holy Wisdom. And the Church of St. Cyrus that they
called. So you're saying that the size or the Dome of the Rock may have been the size of that church?
Without a shadow of a doubt, because okay. It was an octagonal church, and we actually have eight of them that they found here in Israel.
Okay.
We saw the one in Capernaum. We didn't get to see the one in Samaria. There's another one in the suburbs of Jerusalem behind here. But at that time, that the Christians, because they believed the resurrection is the first day of the week, they started making the churches from the fourth, fifth century, all the way up until the sixth, seventh century. When the Muslims came in the Persian conquest, they destroyed the churches and made them into mosques.
Sure.
And then when the Crusaders came, they turned it back into a temple, so to speak. And then when the Muslims came back, they turned it back into, and that's where you have the Dome of the Rock. And nowhere in the world will you ever find a mosque that's like that.
Okay.
You know, it just isn't structured like
and
that.
And really, technically, is that a mosque? The Dome of the Rock.
Yeah, it is a mosque.
Okay.
But I don't know if you'd say technically. From what I understand, there's not a qibla in there.
Uh-huh.
The qibla is the niche that kind of shows toward Mecca.
Okay.
But they use it as a mosque.
Because they always pray toward Mecca.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So the other thing that's very interesting is if we look at the dimensions of the harem, that's what they're calling it, the harem.
So what's the meaning of harem?
It's like the holy place for the Muslims. They call it the okay. Harem Al-Sharif. So if you look at the dimensions of that, every Roman fort was 1,200 by 600 feet square or rectangular. This is almost exactly like that. It's 96% because of the formation of the rock. This is built on a 75-foot protruding rock that from the city of David, when you come across the tunnels, which we're going to do tomorrow, you'll actually see the base of that rock underneath here. So the rock comes up, and that's why they built it, and it's the size of every Roman fort. Now the temple, if you look at the size of the temple from
what fort was that called?
Fort Antonia. And that's what Josephus tells us. Fort Antonia, which is also called the rock, mm-hmm. because of the large protruding rock that's underneath it. The interesting part is, if you're looking at this as the temple, we have a lot of temple records, right? We have the temple scroll from the Dead Sea Scrolls. We have the Mishnah, we have the Talmud, we have the Bible, of course. So there's many, many records that talk about the temple, how it was built. And even in the Book of Kings, I mean, down to the cubic, there is absolutely no record of anything dealing with the temple with a large protruding rock. And just to show you how large
it is. Really the platform, the temple mount, as it's called today.
Yes, and the rock that's underneath the Dome of the Rock, where it actually comes out, it's protruding, which is 58 feet by 51 feet. So if that dome was not there right now, that's what we would be. If we were standing there, you would be on a rock that's 58 feet by 51 feet.
And that does not fit the size of the temple, is what you're stating.
No, the temple is, the Holy of Holies is 30 feet by 30 feet. And not only is that 58 by 51 feet, but it's an oblong rock. It's not flat.
It's not flat, yeah.
No,
yeah.
So there's no reason why you would have that rock in the Holy of Holies. And there's nothing that ever says it. You know, that's the thing. If it was there, I mean, it's a pretty big rock. You would think some historical record would have mentioned it.
Now what about the walls themselves? So what are some of the indicators that that's not the walls of the temple?
Well, these walls here we're looking at were built by Suleiman I in 1538. So these are all from the Ottoman Empire. Below these walls, though, and we can see a little bit over here.
Maybe the corner there.
Exactly, the corner there. But mostly on the south side and the west side, there's about 10,000 Herodian stones. Some of those stones up to 8 tons, one stone. Mm-hmm. That are still there today. So again, if we look in the Bible, Nehemiah 2, Nehemiah 3, Nehemiah 12, the Bible tells us exactly about this wall being built, the wall of the temple at least anyway. And it tells us that when Nehemiah came, he came right through here, right through the Kidron Valley, right? And the stones were all there. He couldn't even get his donkey through. And he came up with this plan to rebuild the walls. Already Ezra had built the temple and he was going to rebuild the walls. And the Bible tells us the miracle that happened, that 52 days, with very few men, they built the walls. Now, as we're looking at this wall, going all the way down, it's only the eastern wall. Even today, it would be impossible for crews with equipment, you know, with John Deere's, to build this wall in 52 days.
Yeah, it is quite a long wall. It's certainly
considering,
an amazing thing.
Like it says in the New Testament, that it took the temple 46 years mm-hmm. to build, that you're not going to do that. But yet, in the city of David, where the temple would have been, it would have been a magnificent feat, but they could have done it. They could have done the walls
there. So you're saying the temple was not here,
yes.
right? Not in the traditional Temple Mount, but near the city of David.
Exactly, in the city of David. And remember, in the Bible, the Temple Mount, Mount Zion, which is Mount Zion, and the city of David are synonymous. You know, in
Examples of that.
Second Chronicles 5:2, we see. And which is the city of David, which is Mount Zion. So I don't think from a biblical standpoint, anybody would argue that Mount Zion and the city of David is the same. The problem that happened was, because the Jewish people were out of here for 1,000 years, they kind of lost the location of these places. And up until almost 1900, they didn't even know that was the city of David.
Yeah, and that's amazing. You know, the other thing too is, we've already mentioned Fort Antonia, but what I find fascinating is they have a model at the Israeli Museum.
Yes.
And I'm sure you've seen it.
Probably
the Temple
model.
Mount.
Yes.
And yeah, Fort Antonia right there to the side, small little. And for me, listening to you prior to the recording, for me, that's a very important point, because as a 10th Legion,
yes.
right? Am I correct? Possibly 6,000 to 10,000 men.
Yes.
You know, it's just really impossible. So I think that's a very important point. The size that would be required for that type of legion or that type of military would not be sufficient for what they're showing at the Israeli Museum.
Yes, and Josephus tells us that Fort Antonia was much larger in scope than the temple itself. He said from the northern side, it blocked the temple, and he said it was
Now this is coming north.
Yes, exactly. This is coming north to south, okay. So we're seeing it. And he says it was so large, it was as large as a city, actually several cities. And we were just up there a little while ago,
absolutely.
And you could see it. You could see when you're up there really how large it really is.
And for the Romans, a fort like that, they would have, it's almost like a small city within the fort.
The inward parts had the largeness and form of a palace, it being parted into all kinds of rooms and other conveniences, such as courts and places for bathing, and broad spaces for camps, insomuch that by having all conveniences that cities wanted, it might seem to be composed of several cities, but by its magnificence it seemed a palace. Flavius Josephus, War of the Jews.
The Romans and the Jews do not intermingle whatsoever. So the Roman soldiers that are here, and any other Romans that are here that are helping them, they would be not only in the fort for times of military, they're living in there. Their barracks are going to be in there, their housing is going to be in there, their markets are going to be in there, their temple is going to be in there. Every single thing of the facet of their life is going to be inside that little city more than a fort.
And the model, again going back to this, is really museum. What's your guess? 200-300 men at most?
At most.
And, you know, based on the projections, at least what you believe, and I want to go home, I want to do some reading because this is very, very fascinating.
Yes.
You're saying 6 to 10,000 men.
Which is a legion of troops. And when you look in Josephus, the word that's used for legion, 6,000 troops, every single place in Josephus is translated as legion, mm-hmm. except when you come to the Temple Mount, they change the word to cohort, because okay. it just doesn't fit.
And what's the difference between cohort?
A cohort is 600 compared 600. To a legion is 6,000.
Okay. That's quite a difference.
Yes.
That's quite
but
a difference.
But tagma is the Greek word that they okay. use. So it really should be legion. Every other place, it's legion.
So you got the dilemma of just not enough days for Ezra and Nehemiah to build the wall.
Yes.
You certainly have the issue of the 10th Legion. Where would they be?
Yes.
Let's focus a little bit, unless you have something else to share, but tell us a little bit about the city of David and why you believe it's there.
Yes. Well, one of the main facets of a temple, right, when you're thinking of the temple and you're thinking of the presence of Elohim, right, from the Garden of Eden, it's associated with living water. And Psalm 29 even says Yahweh sits above the water. But it says that Yahweh sits above the deluge, that it's like this deluge of water that's coming there. So the concept, and actually it's in all religions, it's not just in the Bible, is always that a temple is going to be built near living water, because living water represents life. And we know it. We know it even from Ezekiel 47. You know, when the third temple is built, there's water that comes from underneath the temple, and it goes through this Orava right
now,
there.
Now, what was that origin of the water?
The origin of the water would be the Gihon Spring. There's only one water source here in Israel.
And without that source, I mean, really, Jerusalem would not exist today.
No, it couldn't. Not as a big city.
Yeah.
You know, there's like the in Rogel, that's a very small spring that's a little bit south of here. But as far as being a city, you have to have a major water source, and there's only one. Gihon, the gusher.
Now, you were telling me, and again, I've never heard this, very fascinating, that the water would actually come up,
yes.
if I understood you correctly, in the temple.
Yes.
That is amazing. Tell us a little bit more about that.
It would come up, it would gush, the historical records tell us, up to 400 feet. And what would happen is, it's one of only about 12 siphon springs in the entire world that's over here. So the water would gush up from the Gihon, and then it would come over into the Mount of Olives.
Now, what do we hear about these springs gushing up? Like, is that from Josephus, the Bible?
Josephus and other historical records, but from what David Tzilaf, who is the leader of the Ascalon website that took over for Ernest Martin after he passed away, he has 5 historical references that talk about this happening like that. That the water is coming up from the source of the Gihon up to 400 feet, and then it would come over here into a gigantic cavern, and then it would, by gravity, it would come down to the temple from here. So can you imagine? That's all natural.
Yeah, that's amazing. That really is. And you know, I was at the City of David 2014. It really is a phenomenal place.
Yes.
Now, that's Mount Zion then, right? City of David, same thing.
Yes.
Was it always at elevation?
No. In the 2nd century BC, Simon the Hasmonean, because Antioch...
That was part of the Maccabees.
Part of the Maccabees, okay. who are part of the revolt going into Hanukkah. After Antioch Epiphanes sacrifices a pig on the altar there, they felt that the place was defiled, and they felt it was not... It was too easy to conquer, because where the citadel was, David's citadel, was abutted to the temple. So wherever David's tower is, the temple is going to be right next to it. So because of that, after David's citadel was destroyed, which, again, David's not there at that time, in 134, Simon the Hasmonean, Josephus tells us this, for 3 years, took 3,000 men day and night, and moved the earth, actually, from Mount Zion up toward the upper city.
So that hillside would have been much larger at that point.
Exactly. And as you come out of the modern Dung Gate, you can actually see it, because you come out of there in the Typhonian Valley, which is the valley between Mount Moriah and the upper city. And near the western wall, you see the valley, but as you come out of the gate, you see it humped. you start to see where literally where that dirt was moved from.
You were shown earlier, it's kind of hard to see. There's the aqua blue banner, it looks like, down the hill. That would be going towards David's palace or the temple?
Yeah, where the banner is, it's right above the Millo, which separated.
Now explain that term Millo.
Millo means fill.
Okay.
And there was two hills, you could say. There's the Ophel hill where Ornan's threshing floor was that David bought for the temple. And then there was the Akra, which is like a citadel where David builds his palace. But yet between them, it's like a little valley.
Sure.
So you
like
could
a
do
ravine,
a couple. Yeah, like a ravine.
Yes.
So you could build a bridge, I guess, going across. But what Solomon decided to do was actually fill that whole valley up and make it into one ridge.
Okay.
And that's why Psalm 122 says, Jerusalem is a city built unto itself. Because literally it becomes one ridge, the
and
two.
And based on what you understand, we can actually see what was our term again?
The Millo?
The Millo. You can see the Millo.
Yeah, you
can
actually see it there. And you know what's really interesting? In Zechariah 6:12, where it talks about the man whose name is the branch, he will build the temple and he will take the two of them, the two of what, and put them into one. It's the king and priest, right? Because the Akra is the king. The Ophel is where the temple is, the priest. But what does Solomon do, who's a type of Messiah? He puts them into one. The same way, you know, Yeshua is king and priest, and he's coming back to put the two of them. So it's really symbolic that way, too, when you're looking at the Akra and the Ophel as king and priest, and yet the mounds coming into one.
Okay. Now, is there anything else you want to share with us as with the Temple Mount, with the City of David, anything else?
Well, one thing is from this southeast corner here that you can see, right?
Yes.
Josephus tells us from the southwest corner, so on the other side of that corner, that there were two colonnades from the Fort Antonia that went to the temple that were 600 feet long. So actually people say, do you know where exactly the temple could be? And we say, we can know. We can know where the northern wall of the temple is. If you just go where the Alaska Mosque is, and you could see the big mosque where the dome is. From there, if you counted from that wall and just went exactly 600 feet, you would come to the northern wall of the temple. Yeah, that would be the beginning of it.
600 feet from the mosque is the beginning of the temple.
Exactly.
Okay.
And if you put the temple this way, like if the temple is on this mount, not only is there nowhere to put Fort Antonia, they have to make it.
Yes.
There's certainly nowhere to put the colonnades. Because where would you put them? There was nothing that was there. It couldn't go into that area. So that's the problem they have, and that's why I'm actually in one way glad that Avi Yonah made the model the way he did, because it really exposes their problem with putting the Temple Mount here.
Yeah, it does. I think for me, you know, listening to your explanation, because again, this is very new to me.
Yes.
I saw a video on this, I think, a few weeks ago, but Fort Antonia is a big problem.
Yes.
Based on what you're saying, 6,000 to 10,000 troops. Again, looking at the current model that's in the Israeli Museum, there's just no way.
Yep.
There's no way. And, you know, connecting again the Mount Zion with the City of David and with the temple, I think that's pivotal as well. And the other thing, too, is a water source.
Yes.
During the temple, there were sacrifices. You had to have some sort of water source. Is there any water source today or historically on the Temple Mount?
Well,
the traditional Temple Mount.
There's 37 man-made cisterns.
Okay.
Josephus also tells us that where the temple was, there were subterranean tunnels that are in there that we'll be in tomorrow. Over here, there's only man-made cisterns, no subterranean tunnels.
So nothing historically that would say, okay, this was could have been a water source for the temple.
No. There was coming from Bethlehem, there was an aqueduct that came to the Fort Antonia over here because, again, as a city with all those Romans in there, they needed water too.
And that's indicative of Roman architecture,
the
aqueducts. We saw that in Caesarea as a beautiful site with the aqueducts coming. What mount is that again? It comes from a mount.
Mount Carmel?
Carmel,
yes.
So really, really fascinating.
Yeah, and again, you wouldn't if you had a pure water source that you have to have by law, by Jewish law, for your sacrifices, you're not going to forget that and build your temple a third of a mile away and aqueduct water in. It sure. just makes no sense. So the fact that some people will say, no, there was water coming from the aqueduct from Bethlehem, well, of course, because 10,000 people are up there.
But it's important, I think, to realize that the aqueducts were used more for Roman,
absolutely,
not Jews.
Yes.
So very an important point. Anything else?
Yeah, one other point is Josephus also tells us that the towers, like the northeastern tower, was up to 450 feet. The walls were up to between 300 and 400 feet, and the towers were 450. If you look right here at the wall of the harem, it is impossible structurally to build that wall that high. That's like a 40 to 45 story skyscraper. Mm. They didn't have the technology in that day. Well, how can they have it down there? As we're looking at the Kidron Valley slopes way down.
Mm-hmm. So I see that.
Yeah, and we're not even seeing the bottom of it. But from when we stand in the City of David and you look down to the base of the Kidron, you could easily get up to 450 feet without having to, you know, put too much into the imagination. So even just looking at it structurally, it would be impossible to build that wall that high. And what do people say? Josephus exaggerated.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
He's just giving it
an
estimate.
You know, as you've pointed out, and I think this is a good point, a very important point too, they rely on him with everything else.
Yes.
Everything else is good, except evidently with the temple.
Yeah.
And
you know, it's like now, right? If you're not equipped or educated with this subject, I can tell you almost anything. And you can go look it up, but at the time, you're taking my word for it, right? Because we're just looking at it. Remember, Josephus is a contemporary. He's yes. writing these things that people who saw it. So if he's exaggerating like that, somebody would have came out and said, wait a second, I'm seeing this. It wasn't like this. It wasn't built like this. Like the fact over there on the ridge. See that ridge over there? Josephus said the ridge from the Kidron Valley to the Trifonian Valley was exactly 600 feet. You can go there and you can measure. It is exactly 600 feet.
And that's from the mosque?
No, from here. No. Oh, from the City of David, from ridge to ridge where the temple was. He said was 600 feet from ridge
to ridge.
It's exactly 600 feet. They measured it.
Huh.
So it's not 700, it's not 650, it's not 550. Exactly. Over here, it's nowhere near it. It doesn't even, not even close to it, you know, from ridge to ridge. It's about 1,200 feet.
Sure. Yeah. Well, Don, I'd like to thank you for helping us understand this. It really is interesting. And I think, you know, it's good for all of us to rethink, to re-examine the evidence. There's so many traditional thoughts and beliefs. So again, thank you for being here. And by the way, thank you for being our tour guide. You've been very, very good. We've thoroughly enjoyed the trip. Have a few more days, but thank you for being here and sharing this information with us.
Mm-hmm.